Good morning. I love that. There's a different time clock this morning. Our paths are so creative. Let's stand this morning and sing our praise and worship songs. It is the time of year where outside it is very cold. So when you walk into our wonderful church family and feel the warmth and the love that's surrounding us, it makes me want to jump up out of bed and worship with all of our brothers and sisters this morning and every Sunday morning. We love you, Lord. Thank you so much for being us here. Before the world was made, before you spoke it to me, you were the King of Kings. Yeah, you were, and now you're reigning still in front of all of things. Angels and saints cry out, we join them as we sing. Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever.
Glory to God, glory to God, glory to God forever.
Creator God, you gave me breath so I could breathe. Your great and majesty, all my days, all my days. So let my whole life be a blazing offering, a light that shouts and sings the greatness.
The kindness of a sinner. Dear God, I promise if you give me a parking space, I'll attend your church on Sunday. Never mind, God.
To start coming to church. Well, good morning, and grace to you in peace in the name of our Savior, Lord Jesus Christ. It's so good to greet each of you and to welcome you to worship this morning. Thank you for being a part of this worship experience on this Lord's Day. We're just delighted to have you here. We may even get a little rain today. God is good, and we certainly need it. The people of Chimney Rock and Lake Lure certainly need it, but we're glad you're here. Thank you for taking time out of a busy schedule, even with the home Panther game today, to be here for worship, and we're so proud of you. Let's bow our heads and offer thanks to the Lord. Let's pray together. All things come from you, O God, and it's with gratitude that we return to you what really is yours. Because, God, you created all that is, and with love you formed us in your image. You gave us your only Son, Jesus Christ, to be our Savior. And, God, we know that all that we are and all that we have is a trust from you. And so, in gratitude for all your gifts, we offer ourselves today, and we offer all that we have in union with Christ's offering for us. Hear our prayer, O Lord. Accept our worship as an offering to you. Give us your strength and be our shield. We pray this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. Moving into what really is an exciting time in the life of Imagine Church, you received as you came in this morning a little card about our Thanksgiving dinners. And I want to thank you for the way that you have honored that request. We have about 75 names that we've received from the social workers in the local schools in Charlotte and York County. And on the 23rd of November, the day before Thanksgiving, we're going to meet up here, as many of you as can, at 11 o'clock a.m. We're going to have prayer together. Then we're going to take these boxed meals and deliver them to these families. And it really is such a touching experience. Last year, when Tyra and Joshua and I took ours around, we got to one house, and the whole family was waiting out on the front porch for us. It really touched our hearts. And I know it blessed you to be a part of that a year ago. Last year, we did about 50 meals. This year, we believe we can do 75. And I heard from Carrie DiDonato, who was at a swim team meet this morning and couldn't be with us. But she told me last night that we've had 43 already subscribed. And this week, I was at Wells Fargo, which is our church's bank, and they were asking me what our church was doing for Thanksgiving, and I told them a little bit about it. And later that day, Brittany York, the teller that I worked with, or the banker that I worked with, she said, well, put us down for a couple because our bank wants to be part of that with you. And that really touched my heart. So if you feel led to do this, they're $50 per meal. And we've had Danielle Bauer working with us on coordinating the menu. And I think Publix is going to be the one we're going with this year. Carrie has been the one that's taking care of all the routes. And Scott Rowley and Tim Gunn are going to pick up the meals for us on that day, the 23rd. So if you want to be a part of this and willing to provide one or more meals, just note that on the card, put it in the offering plate, and you can give your check anytime between now and Thanksgiving. We'd be grateful if you'd be a part of that with us. Well, a number of you survived Great Wolf Lodge yesterday. I think we had almost 40 from our church that went. Our Imagination Youth and Imagine Kids were all both a part of that outing. And Andrea Gunn, thank you for putting that together for us. But even the adults who went don't look none the worse for the wear, so it must have been a fun outing, and we're proud of you for going and being a part of that. Well, next Sunday is the culmination of the series that we've been embarked upon over the last few weeks called The Generous Life, and it really is a sacred day in the life of the church. What a difference it's made for us over the last year, that a year ago we had our first Commitment Sunday, when each of us accepted the sacred duty of making a commitment to support the church financially over the coming year. And I'm so proud of you because of the things that that has made possible for us and all that you've done in the name of Christ. You know, when we began this church years ago, it really began as a vision in just the minds and hearts of a couple people, and one in particular that met with me and said, Bruce, don't have fear about this. This is something that God is calling you and leading you to do. Go for it. But we knew that by not being a denominational church, we were giving up any prospect of denominational startup help. Everything that's happened here has been because of the generosity of individuals as God has touched their hearts. And we had people in the beginning who behind the scenes contributed to make this happen, to make this possible. And now, if you notice on Sunday morning, the screens, the announcements that scroll at the beginning of the screen, every week we put up there what the offering is. And it has just been such an inspiration to watch how God has continued to prompt the hearts of our people here. And when we began, we were having offerings of, you know, $400 or $500 a week, and now you can see what it is. And we're not really yet a large church family. We believe one day we will be. We're on the way to that. But God has just touched the hearts, and it's not one or two people giving everything and a few others giving very little. It's all doing what they can as God prompts them. That's what's making a difference in the life of this church and making this ministry possible. And so every week as I look at that screen when it comes up on the announcement slides, I'm so grateful to God for what God has done in the past, for what God is doing now, and for the promise in God's goodness and grace of what is yet to be, and I thank you for that. Next Sunday, we'll have the privilege of being able to bring these cards and their envelopes that are you'll be receiving this week. We had some great help this week. Amy Davis and Kelly Link helped put together the packets that were mailed yesterday, so hopefully you'll get them tomorrow or Tuesday. And I do ask you to take a look at the information in that packet. There's a lot of it in there. And then you'll find this commitment card in an envelope. But if you would, please, we just ask you to prayerfully make a decision as an individual, as a couple, or as a family of your level of support for God's work in the coming year. And then just put this in the envelope and bring it with you to church next week. Now, there's a return label on the envelope for any who cannot be here next week. But if you're going to be in town, I pray that you'll be here, because there's something about that act of getting up out of our seats and coming forward. The altar table, the communion table will be down front here. And leaving this commitment card on that table as an act of discipleship is something that is so deeply meaningful to me, and I believe to you as well. And then we'll have a prayer of dedication for the commitments that have been made. And that will undergird and support and make possible the work of God's ministry through Imagine Church in the coming year. We have some great dreams and hopes and ideas for ministry next year, some of which are outlined on the information that you'll receive this week in the packet. And all that is so exciting, but it will be made possible through you and through your goodness. And so thank you in advance for being generous and for the response that I know you'll make, because I know you and I've come to know your hearts. And the way God speaks to you is demonstrated by the way that you serve Him. And so for your loyalty to the church, for your love of Christ, and for your service to God, in the name of Imagine Church, I thank you. Thank you in advance. Jennifer, you want to say a word about our Imagine Kids and the rehearsal?
I'll just stand here briefly and just remind those of you who are here that we do have practice today. And if you are, I know there's some people up in the balcony, maybe Lauren, you may be up there. I saw if you guys are planning to help out with any of the props or the sets, it's not going to be that very elaborate. But as simple as it's going to be, we still need some volunteers. We need some people to help with our nativity scene children to make sure that it goes smoothly and that everyone knows what they're doing. So we do have practice probably about 15 minutes after service. So if you plan to be a part of that in any way, shape, form, volunteer, or if you know you're in the show that has already been cast or production, please plan to stay around. Thanks.
Thank you so much, Jennifer, and thank you for your work on the play, and also Tyra's work, and a number of our adults are involved in this. It really is going to be a deeply meaningful experience in worship on December 18th, when we're able to recognize and honor those who are part of our church through the play, and that'll be an exciting moment for us. Can you tell it's a Panthers home game? We have a little more elbow room whenever there is one of those. That's just part of life these days, but there's also a swim meet that involves a large number of our kids and their families and Panthers game. We caught a break in that one Panther home game is actually going to be on Thursday night later this week, and that won't interfere with church worship. But we thank you for your faithfulness and for being here today. Even when there are 1,000 other things that could call you to be elsewhere, we're grateful that you're here. We're proud of you for the way you honor God. This past Friday was a special day in the life of our country. It was Veterans Day, and we wanted to pause in our worship this morning to honor those who are part of our Imagine Church family and a part of our individual families who have served this country in such an important and significant way as members of the armed services. We're going to take a moment now, and we're going to honor our veterans as you watch this, and then we'll continue with our recognition.
Three teens were arrested today for defacing the Kensington Park War Memorial overnight. The destruction includes painted messages against the military and the war in the Middle East. The three teams were picked up the early morning hours and the evidence was left with the scene.
Grandpa, something wrong?
Some people sure have short memories, and those who are too young to know need to be taught. Come on, I want to show you guys something.
Thank you. I vexed the hearts of my own monsters. I became a more than a one for dignity, for honor, for righteousness' sake, for God and country. I fought for you.
I fought for you.
For you.
I fought for you.
I fought for you.
I fought for you.
I fought for you.
For you.
For you.
For you.
For you. I fought for you.
I fought for you.
I fought for you, and I do it again.
The U.S. military veterans on Veterans Day. No citizen performs a higher honor than to take up arms to protect one's country or to be willing to make the ultimate sacrifice in the cause of liberty. And we are grateful to the U.S. service veterans who are an honored part of our church family or our individual families and who fought for the sake of freedom. And it's a privilege for us today to be able to pause in our worship and to recognize them. And so I just wonder if we might do it this way. If I know we have at least one who's a member of the armed services who is here today. But if you've had or do have a member of your family who serves in any of these different branches of the uniformed service, I want to ask you to represent them. And if you would stand as I call the names of the different branches of service and then remain standing until all have been called and all have been recognized. And so today, on behalf of our Commander-in-Chief, President Barack Obama, the Secretary of Defense, Robert M. Gates, Chair of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, Admiral Michael Mullen, and the citizens of the United States of America, as well as the fellow members of Imagine Church, I hope that you'll please accept, on behalf of yourself and members of your family, our sincere expression of gratitude, admiration, and affection for your selfless service to our nation and for the causes of liberty and peace in the world. And so, if you serve or have served, or if someone in your family serves or has served, let me ask you to stand as I call out the different branches. The United States Army. The United States Air Force. Please continue to stand. The United States Navy. The United States Marine Corps. The United States Coast Guard. The United States National Guard. And the United States Military Reserve. Isn't that impressive? Let's pray together. We thank you today, dear God, for those men and women of the armed forces who are willing to make that ultimate sacrifice for our freedom. And many left family and loved ones to go and serve because they knew there are some causes that are more valuable than even life itself. And so as we think about Veterans Day, may we each lift up a prayer for the veterans of past wars and those of today who followed the call of their country, who took up arms, and who gave their all. God, we continue to pray for peace in our world. We ask that you'd restrain the evil forces that sometimes set the trap of misunderstanding and division, whereby your children are caught in the trap of war. We pray for wisdom to seek peace and to pursue it, for faith and character to use aright the powers that we have our hands upon. And to that end, O God, our prayers rise for our troops, for our sailors and airmen, for our president and all who influence our policies, and for us, the whole body of people, the tragic sacrifices of war may not end in the disillusionment of our hopes and the despair of our children after us. God, we know there will be no peace for the world until it springs from the hearts of people. And so we pray for ourselves. Make us worthy to live in so momentous a time. Deliver us from self-centered living, from narrowness of vision, and from wasting character in a time when the world's hope depends on character. Cleanse our lives, O God, and set us to seek first your kingdom and your righteousness. We want to pray together now the words of our Lord as he taught us to pray, if you look at the screen, and may we pray these words together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever. Amen. You may be seated. I know we have one here today who is active duty military at present, and that is Kirk Scholler. Kirk, what branch are you in? U.S. Army, I thought so. And Brad Newstead, who is not here today, is also active duty military. Any others that are active at present? Kirk, would you stand? We want to express our appreciation to you individually. Kirk, we're proud of you. Well, it's not every week that we pick a lay reader who has had such a significant milestone event in her life as turning 15. But that's what we have today with Lauren Gilkison, who just this week turned 15 and is our lay reader today. And so I wonder if you would join me in expressing appreciation to Lauren as she comes forward to share in worship.
Immediately Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of him to the other side. While he dismissed the crowd, after he had dismissed them, he went up to the mountainside by himself to pray. Later that night, he was there alone. Will you please join me in prayer? Dear Lord, thank you for today and for allowing all of us to be here. We thank you for Imagine Church and for those that are here with us today, as well as those who may be traveling. Lord, we ask that you watch over those that are suffering and show us how we can help lead others to you. Please be with Pastor Bruce today as he delivers the message, and please open our hearts and minds so that we may hear and embrace your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you, God, for trusting me to be his dad.
Thank you, Lord, that when a door closes, you're still going to take care of me.
And thank you for Cheetahs and Pickles and Vitamins and Mommies and Daddy.
Thank you.
videos this morning are giving all of us a case of the sniffles. At least it's happening to me. Well, I want to begin this morning by pointing out what I think is one of the most fascinating things about the Bible. And I don't know if you read the Bible or not, or what your attitude is or perspective about the Bible, but one of the coolest things to me is, if you read the New Testament, the thing that you're struck by is that the theme of the New Testament is that individuals are invited to connect with God, not through consistency or ritual or tradition, but people are encouraged to connect with God through faith. The big word in the New Testament is the word faith, or trust, or confidence in. And a person connects with God through Jesus by saying, I'm placing my trust or my confidence in Christ as my personal Savior. That Christ paved the way for me to reconnect with God. So we come to God in Jesus Christ as an act of faith. And the reason that's so important is because there's actually 400 years between the end of the writing of the Old Testament and the beginning of the writing of the events of the New Testament. 400 years. Just let that settle in on you for just a minute. 400 years between. And yet the Old Testament is what sets up this event, this amazing thing that we find in the New Testament. Some people call it the 400 years of silence. But nobody could suspect that somebody kind of strung this story together. Because there was nobody still around when the second part started, because there was such a big gap. But the theme of the Old Testament is that the relationship humanity had with God was broken by the very same issue that the New Testament addresses. And that is the issue of trust. Humanity was separated from God because in the beginning, as the story goes, the first two people who ever lived said something to God that we've all said in our own way, one way or another. They said, God, we don't trust you. We don't think you have our best interests in mind. God, we know the difference between right and wrong. We think you're keeping something good from us. How many times have you kind of violated your conscience or disobeyed what you thought God would have you do? Because you thought you were smarter, or you had something else in mind, or you were afraid that if you obeyed God or did the right thing, that you'd miss out on something good. Don't we all have that story? That's really how the whole thing started. And it started because they decided that God couldn't be trusted. I can't trust God. This is really rather amazing. And so it would make sense that when Jesus came along, he would say, you know what? We're going to repair this thing the same way that it was broken. Because what was broken was trust. So you know what? You come back into God's good graces. You become a child of God, not through doing a bunch of good stuff, because the relationship really wasn't broken by doing a bunch of bad stuff. It was broken because humanity decided we don't trust God. And so in the New Testament, we discover that the relationship was healed through an act of faith or trust. The point being this: that your faith and my faith in God is extremely important to God. It's the essence of our relationship with God. So when you hear us talk about a growing relationship with Jesus Christ, what we're talking about growing is really, in fact, our faith. And what God really wants to do in your life is to grow your faith. Because as your faith grows and matures and develops, your intimacy with God grows and matures and develops. It's the development of our faith or our confidence in God that gives us the kind of relationship that God wants us to have. And so your faith and my faith are really very important to God. Consequently, throughout our life, God is working to grow our faith. And you've met people, no doubt, maybe the one who first invited you to church. But you've met people with that kind of faith. They just trust God no matter what, in good times and in bad times. They give Him credit for the good, they trust Him in the bad. They just have this uncanny, sometimes almost irritating confidence in God's presence in their lives. And that's because they've worked with God to allow God to grow their faith. And that's what God wants to do in all of us. So what I want to do this morning is talk about something that God uses to grow our faith. This seems to be the way of God in the hearts of men and women who, as God seeks to grow our faith. So let me get at it this way. If you've been a Christian for very long, and I were to ask you to tell your faith story, and you were to answer the question, what did God use to really grow and stretch your faith? You'd probably tell me about a time in your life when somebody presented you with an opportunity to do something, or you were sitting somewhere and somebody talked about a need and you became aware of that need. And after that conversation was over, you couldn't get it off your mind. And you felt this internal nudge to get involved with something. Might have been a ministry. Might have been something in the community. But you just felt this internal nudge to get involved with something that served and benefited other people. And as you told your story, you'd say something like this. You know what? I didn't feel equipped. I didn't feel prepared. I didn't think I was smart enough. And I thought, if I do this, I'm going to make a fool of myself. But I felt so drawn to this group of people. And I felt so drawn to that organization or to that need. And you would say, you know what? I realized it wasn't guilt. But as your story would go along, you'd say, you know, eventually I just felt like maybe God was nudging me in my heart to do that. To get involved, to call them, whatever it might be. And so you did. And you tell a story about how scared you were and how unprepared you were and how you went at it with fear and trembling and you were thinking, it's going to be a disaster, I'm going to embarrass myself. And then as you got involved, you began to see God do amazing things that would become part of your faith story. And so this morning, I want to talk a little bit about that dynamic. About the tension and the fear that we all have. And one of the reasons I want to talk about it is this. Some of you, maybe many of you, are in the middle of a tug of war with God right now over something just like that. There's something that God just seems to bring back to your mind and back to your heart over and over and over. As it relates to the needs of a certain group of people, or to a ministry, or to something in this church. And what I want you to understand about it is this. The issue in that wrestling match is not just the benefit of the group of people that you might get involved with and what they might derive. The issue is not just those people over there need somebody to help them. The issue isn't, well, those people need somebody to serve them. That's part of it. That's part of it. But maybe the bigger issue for you is that God wants to use something outside of your comfort zone to stretch and to build your faith. And so He's inviting you outside of what's comfortable. He's inviting you outside of your skill set. He's inviting you outside your experience to serve someone else, to do something for someone else. And that tension, that wrestling match, and if you're not having it now, I can promise you, you will, because it's something that God uses over and over and over. What I want you to understand today is this. That is a faith issue. That God wants to exhaust your faith muscle in order to build it up. And this is how He does it. Now, one of the best examples in the Bible of this comes just following the story that we read and studied last week. Do you remember? Now, that's a faith issue for me to think that you still remember what I preached on last Sunday, okay? But it was from the Gospel of Matthew. It was the story of the feeding of the 5,000. Way to go. Thank you, Andrew. The feeding of the 5,000 with just 5 loaves and 2 fish. You remember the story? And what we said last week is that that story was a great example of a principle that is still at work today. And that is this. If we do what we know we can do, then we get the incredible privilege of watching God do what only God can do. That's the story of this church. If we do what we can do, then we know God will be faithful and we'll do what only God can do. It works every time. Jesus had these loaves and fish and He breaks it up and He hands it out to His 12 guys. Jesus just gives back to them what they brought Him. And all they did was they did what they knew they could do. They turned and they served the food that they had. They simply did what they knew how to do. They turned around and started giving it to the people. But they trusted Jesus to do what only Jesus can do. And when it was over, when they'd all been fed, the disciples turned around and they picked up 12 basketfuls of pieces that were left over. And when they did, the disciples looked at each other and they said, "We didn't do that." They said, "I mean, we're here, we're doing our part, but you can't give us credit for that. We simply did what we knew how to do. But we're telling you, God showed up and God did what only God can do." Jesus knew that if their faith in Him wasn't strong, and their confidence in Him wasn't strong, that this mission that He was about to hand over to them wouldn't work at all. So all of this is simply to teach the disciples to trust Him, and then to trust Him more. Well, then as soon as lesson 101 is finished, He gets ready to give them lesson 201. We're going to pick up the story where we left off last week. Matthew chapter 14, beginning at verse 22. The Bible says immediately, and that's very important, because these two stories are connected. That's what that means. Immediately, Jesus made the disciples get into the boat and go on ahead of Him to the other side while He dismissed the crowd. And that would have been interesting, Jesus trying to dismiss a crowd where He'd healed everybody and fed everybody. "All right, you guys are dismissed." And they think, "No, we think we're just going to stick with you, Jesus, because this is kind of working for us." But somehow Jesus dismisses the crowd. And after He had dismissed them, He went up on a mountainside by Himself to pray. Now that's another lesson in and of itself. Talk about private disciplines. Jesus went off by Himself to pray. He did that very often. So He went by Himself to pray, and when it was evening, when evening had come, there He was alone. Verse 24, but the boat, now the disciples are in the boat, they're heading back across the lake. They left just as the sun was going down. But the boat was already a considerable distance from land, buffeted by the waves because the wind was against it. Remember, this is lesson 201, okay? So now these guys are rowing across the lake. How difficult could that be? They row across this lake and around this lake all the time. A bunch of these guys are fishermen. They're thinking, "Hey, we can handle this." But they get about halfway out, a considerable distance out into the lake. It's dark. It's pitch black dark. And they're rowing against the wind. And all of a sudden they realize, you know, this is good exercise, but it's not going anywhere. We're basically in a stationary rowing machine out in the middle of the wind. We're rowing, but we're not moving, and there's not even a television to watch while we're out here getting our exercise. So they're out there in the middle of that pitch black dark, and they can't make any progress. And this is something they're really good at. This is something they're trained for. This is something they've done before. But the story continues, verse 25. Shortly before dawn, so they've been out there all night. Shortly before dawn, Jesus went out to them walking on the lake. And when the disciples saw Him walking on the lake, they were, what's the word? They were terrified. "It's a ghost," they said, and they cried out in fear. Now, one of the things that to me gives the Bible credibility is that the guys who wrote this made themselves look really, really bad. Now, 2,000 years later, in the church tradition, there's St. Matthew and St. Mark, and there's St. John and St. James. There's a building in Rome that's built for Peter and got his name on it. These guys, they're actually the superheroes of the faith. But when you look at their lives the way they describe them, because Matthew wrote this, Matthew was there. He was an eyewitness to all this. They never really looked very good. And one of the reasons that this gives the Bible credibility is because they don't say, "And then we saw Jesus walking on the water and we said, Jesus, 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 Jesus." I mean, if I'm writing this and I'm making the whole thing up and it's just fiction anyway, I don't write myself into the story as a coward. You don't write the whole group being a coward. But that's what they did. And so in the story, they see Jesus and listen to what they said. "It's a ghost," they said, and they cried out in fear. They thought He was a ghost. No great faith here, right? Verse 27. But Jesus immediately said to them, "Take courage, it is I. Don't be afraid." And in that moment, Peter has an insight. Peter's like, oh, I see what's going on. I've got this. I was standing there earlier today, and he gives me this little bit of fish and a little bit of bread, and he says, feed these people. And I can't feed people with that. But I say, well, whatever. And I turn around, and what happened was just a miracle. And then Jesus told us to get into the boat and row across, and we knew that we couldn't do this. Peter's like, Jesus, you knew the whole time. We're going to be out here getting exercise, and we're not going anywhere, so this is a lesson. There's something to this, and I think I understand it. I think that we can do anything Jesus asks us to do if we do what we know how to do, and then somehow trust Him for the rest. And then Peter decides to test this theory. Listen to what happens. Peter says, this is verse 28, Lord, if it's you, and I'm really hoping that it's you, okay? If it's you, Peter replied, tell me to come to you on the water. Now please listen to this because this is so important. This is what Peter understood. Peter realized, I can't do this by myself. I'm going to jump out of this boat and I'm just trusting Jesus. Now, some might look at that and say, that's not faith, that's just stupidity. A lot of things have been done or launched under the banner of, I'm going to do a great thing and I'm just going to trust Jesus under that banner. Peter understood the lesson. Peter said, the lesson is that whenever the Savior asks me to do something that I'm incapable of doing, whenever He invites me out of my comfort zone, whenever He invites me to do things that don't make any sense, and I might embarrass myself, whenever He invites me to do something that's bigger than my capability, when I simply do what I know to do, then He does what only He can do. That's why Peter says, Jesus, invite me. Please invite me. And the guys in the boat are going, what is this? If you want to go out there, just go out there. And Peter's going, no, I understand this. He's got to ask me first. Because if He asks me, then I know if I do what I can do, He's going to do what He can do. So Jesus, come on, invite me. Invite me out of the boat. Isn't that dramatic? Who would have made this up? And then verse 29. Come, Jesus said. And then Peter got down out of the boat and he walked on the water. And he came toward Jesus. Do you know what Peter did? He did the same thing he did when Jesus passed out the bread and the fish. Peter said, I don't know how to walk on water, but I know how to get out of a boat. And I know how to walk. And that's where my limitations are. But I'll do what I know how to do. I know how to get out of a boat. I know how to walk. And now Jesus has invited me. And so I'm going to see if Jesus will do what only Jesus can do on my behalf. Now folks, that right there is the Christian experience to a great degree. I dare you to start praying Peter's prayer. Lord, invite me out of my comfort zone. Please invite me out of my comfort zone. God, I want you to use me in the lives of other people. I don't want to just have to come up with an idea. I want the assurance that you are inviting me out of my comfort zone. And then Jesus, God, I'm going to do what I know how to do. And I can't wait to see what you are going to do. For some of you, He's already inviting you right now. For some of you, it means making a commitment to give and you've never done that before and it's scared you to death. For some of you, it means volunteering in Imagine Kids or in Imagination Youth. And I know there's a part of you, you can't get your own teenage experience out of your mind. You think about high school students and you think, well, I could never work with them because I'm not cool. They'll ask me a question. They'll say, well, what if? And I can't answer. And Jesus says, come on, you know how to fill out a form. You know how to walk down a hall. You know how to read. Come on, I'm inviting you. I'm inviting you. And I want you to do what you know you can do And then I want you to watch me do what only I can do on your behalf. Wow. Verse 30. You know the story by now, but listen to this word because this is so huge. Verse 30. But when he saw the wind, Peter, when Peter saw the wind, he was reminded of what he couldn't do, wasn't he? And he was afraid. And beginning to sink, he cried out, Lord, save me. Verse 30. And immediately, here's that word again. Immediately, Jesus reached out his hand and he caught him and he said, you of little, what's the word? Faith. This is all about faith. This isn't about, hey, I've got another idea for a miracle, guys. This is all about faith. There is an agenda. I'm trying to teach you guys to trust me for what you can't do. Oh, you of little faith, he said, why did you doubt me? You began looking at your ability, and we looked at your ability, you forgot to trust me, and in not trusting me, you doubted me. I'm just making this part up. I don't know how this really went down, obviously, but I don't think Jesus was chastising Peter. I mean, there were 11 other guys in the boat. There were 11 other guys to chastise. At least Peter says, come on, call me out. I think maybe, and this is the parent in me, but I think maybe he grabs Peter by the hand and he said, Peter, you almost had it. You were so close. Why did you doubt me, Peter? You got it. You understood. You made the right call. You asked the right question. Peter, you were so close. Why? Right there at the end, did you take your eye off the ball and doubt me? And I love the way it ends, verse 32. And when they climbed into the boat, the wind died down. And those who were in the boat worshipped him, saying, truly, you are the Son of God. We suspected it before. I mean, that whole loaves of bread and fish thing. But I'm telling you, now we know. We're in. Truly, no doubt in our mind, you are absolutely, once and for all, you are the Son of God. Now, here's what I want you to take away from here this morning. The fact that we're even gathering for worship here today is because there was a group of people who experienced this in their life, and they said, you know, we're going to get out of the boat. We've got 20 or 25 or 30 children, who knows, today who are coming to know Jesus Christ more closely than Imagine Kids. Because Tyra and a small little group of volunteers said, we've never done anything quite like this before. But we're going to do what we know how to do. And then watch God do what only God can do. And there are families today who are being blessed by this ministry because a handful of people back 2 years ago were willing to get out of the boat and do something they had never done before. And look what God has done. This past summer, we brought Tim and Andrea Gunn to Imagine Church to lead our Imagination Youth Ministry. We hadn't had a real youth minister, professional youth minister before. Cahill and Lauren both did it as volunteers. But they felt, they knew before the rest of us, that God was nudging us to get out of the boat. God's been nudging us to get out of our comfort zone. And now look how God has started to use Tim and Andrea and Matt and Annie Hubbard in our student ministry here. And I'm telling you, anywhere you see God doing anything, if you dig down far enough, you've got to find somebody for whom this is their story. To practically any one of our ministries, you'll find people who sat in here like you do, and they saw a need, and they couldn't get it out of their minds. And they realized, you know, I'm not a super Christian. Please don't ask me to do anything hard. But I guess I can take care of children. I know I can fix refreshments. I know I can fix a meal. I know I can take up an offering. And you know what? They did what they knew how to do. And you talk to them now, and it's like, of course I give God the credit. I just knew how to get out of the boat. I just knew how to take a step. I can't take credit for walking on water. I can't take credit for what God is doing in the lives of these kids. But aren't you glad that somebody did that once upon a time for you? Aren't you glad that someone introduced you to Christ or invited you to church? That God put you on their mind? That God put you on their heart? Instead of just praying, well, I hope God brings somebody along who's going to reach out. No, they did what they knew how to do. They picked up the phone, they made a call. They invited you to sit down for a conversation. They invited you into their group. And you look at them and you see them now like St. Matthew and St. John and St. Peter. And they're going, no, that's not me. I'm a coward. I'm insecure. I'm afraid. That's why I give God all the credit. So here's the question I have for you this morning. Where is God nudging you? What is God urging you to do? You try to get it out of your mind. You try to excuse it. We all have these excuses, but it just won't go away. You see, the issue isn't, if you don't go over there won't be enough. No. The issue is you. The issue is your faith. The issue is that God wants to do something in you and in your faith and in your intimate relationship with Him. And this is one place where you have a role to play. You've got to turn around. You've got to feed those people with what's in your hand, even though you know that's not enough. You've got to throw your legs over the side of that boat and take a step, even though you don't know the first thing about walking on water. This is everyone's story, to some extent. For anyone that God has used for anything, the known and the unknown. So the question I want to end with this morning is the same one I used last week. Would you be willing to do what you know how to do and then trust God to do what only God can do? Would you be willing to do what you know how to do in terms of service, in terms of giving, in terms of serving people in those areas where you just feel God kind of nudging you? Would you be willing to take that first step? Not because you're ready. Not because you're ready, but because God is calling you out of the boat. Would you be willing to do what you can do? And then trust God to do what only God can do. Because if you do, you're going to experience God in a brand new way. And if you don't, then you may never know what God might have done through you. If you had just said, I'm going anyway. I'm going in spite of what I'm incapable of, what I'm untrained to do. Would you be willing to participate with God in this way? Because it'll grow your faith. It'll grow your faith like nothing else.
Thank you, Pastor Ruth, for distinguishing for us how Jesus needs to invite us to what his plans are instead of going at it alone, and that he is trying to teach us to trust him to do what he can do through us and what we can't do by ourselves. Thank you very much for that. It's now time for our offering, and would you please join me in prayer? Heavenly Father, we thank you for your message through Pastor Bruce. We thank you for reminding us to lean onto you, to depend onto you, to rely on you, to put our trust in you, to be willing to get out of the boat, and that to realize that we need to keep our eyes on you instead of the circumstances. And that's very challenging, but we ask that you would work in our hearts and our minds, that we would recall that when the rubber meets the road, when times get really tough, and we start to take our eye off the ball, help us to remember to put our gaze back onto you. That's where we'll find success in you. Father, thank you for this opportunity that we can come together to learn about you, to grow in faith, and to give back to you. Thank you for watching over Imagine Church. Thank you for advancing your kingdom through Imagine Church. Lord, I ask that you would watch over and guide the givers and be with all those who are here today and those who couldn't be here today. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. And everyone together said, Amen. Amen.
My heart is so proud, my mind is so focused. I see the things you do through me as great things I have done. And now you gently bring me, then lovingly you take me.
Walk in
the power of my daily sufficient grace.
And that magnificent song, and the message of that song is so powerful and touches so many hearts. Can we pray together? Heavenly Father, you know what's running through our minds and hearts. And as you work in this way over and over and over, God, it changes us. And we know that you work this way all the time. So God, in spite of the excuses, if you've been nudging and urging some of us to do something for your kingdom, we pray, oh God, that we would just do it and then trust you. So God, regardless of age, would you just lead us to step out and to trust you, to do what we know that you're leading us to do, both as individuals but also as a church family. And Father, for the person who's so grateful, for the people who invested in them when they were new Christians, and they were thinking, I don't think I've been at this long enough, that they would just step out and say, okay, I'm going to do this. Lord, wherever we are, I pray that we would be men and women who are so committed to participating with you as you grow and stretch our faith, that we would do what millions of Christians have done through the ages, and that is simply say yes to you and do what we know how to do, and then to trust you to do what only you can do. Father, I pray that. And I pray that for us, and I pray it for Imagine Church, that we would be characterized by that kind of faith and confidence in you. And I pray all of these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Let's stand together and sing our completing worship song, Forever. Forever God is faithful. We will give all the thanks, glory, honor, and praise to our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ.
Give thanks to the Lord, our God is king. His love endures forever. For he is good, he's above all things. His love
check, but he is recovering, recuperating. Please pray for Ken Davis. Pray for our congregation, for our church family this week as we make our decision about our commitments. Next Sunday is Commitment Sunday. Be here for that. It's always one of those supremely holy moments in worship. And then on Wednesday the 23rd, we're going to pass out our Thanksgiving dinners and deliver them. And then, believe it or not, November 27th begins the season of Advent. Can you imagine that? And we're beginning a brand new series called Home for Christmas. And it's going to be one of those fun series that I hope you'll be here for. So we've got some great things to look forward to. But I thank you for your faithfulness before God, for the way that you honor and serve God during the week, and for being here so faithfully in worship on Sundays. Will you pray this prayer after me? Lord Jesus, we love you. And we go now to serve you. Amen.
Sorry I took your job.